Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Mrinmoy Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today, we will discuss a module on Introduction to Non-British Literature in English, Canadian and Australian Perspective. In this module, we will learn about the English literature as a category emerged in Australia and Canada. The history of English literature in Canada and Australia will be traced back from the British invasion in the respective regions and their encounter with the native or Aboriginal people of Australia and Canada. This new category of English literature includes literature written by the European descendants, Aboriginal writers, the community literatures of the Aboriginal people, and the diasporic literatures. This module briefly describes the history of emergence of English literature from Australia and Canada, and the role of this new literary category in English literary studies, along with significance of these new voices in formation of world literature and the study of comparative literature. Such new literary categories in English studies also will be attempted to be understood in comparison with the context of emergence of English literature in India. Through this study, this module also will try to understand the politics of literary imagination and representation and needs of different disciplines in literature. The possibility of English literature in Australia and Canada has been emerged with the British invasion in the regions and their communication with the Aboriginal communities. Cultural hegemony and administrative power through colonization and the later establishment of empire, whole of this process of civilizing mission, punishment and making people disciplined, penetration of European epistemology and imagination of literature among the people of the colonies. This historical phenomena is common to all the ex-colonies of the British. British made people learned English and European literature, which offered a new exposure among the people of the different indigenous communities and brought a sense of requirement of archiving, recording their own knowledge, history, and literature, which also appeared as resistance against cultural cannibalism of the colonizers. Emergence of Aboriginal literature in Australia and Canada was because of different political and historical causes. Aboriginal people of Australia and Canada were not recognized by the European invader. Moreover, the land of these people were assumed and announced by the Europeans as the land of no citizens. This is how ignorance and ethnic, cultural, racial, social tortures happened to the people originally lived in the land of Australia and Canada. The beginning of indigenous literature in Australia and Canada happened with the hand of Europeans and or the hand of the people of European descent. Later on, a group of indigenous writers emerged from the communities with the expansion of education and rights given to them by the European administrators or the government of the respective regions. We can find three kinds of contribution in the history of indigenous literature in the Australia and Canada as well. One is the literary contribution by the Europeans, like documentation of language, writing grammar of different languages, documentation of different cultural forms, etc. Second is the literature written on or about the indigenous people, or about the encounter happened between indigenous people and the Europeans by the European descents. And third, which is most powerful, different and revolutionary, is the literature written by the indigenous people. Indigenous literature in Australia and Canada has come across different experiences in the way of becoming. Urge for establishing identity, establishing voice to reclaiming the existence, voice of protest and resistance against the European colonialism and cultural hegemony marked indigenous literature essential, integral and deeply rooted with the community itself. We can understand that the emergence of indigenous literature is very crucial, very significant tool for the community, not to revive their cultural past, not to establish their identity, but reclaiming their literary heritage, their existence and their right to the land, and to resist against the literary hegemony which was imposed by the colonizers. Now let us talk about what is non-British English literature. Non-British English literature includes the literature written in English or translated into English from the ex-colonies of the British. Such literary category is quite often identified as Commonwealth literature, new literature, and world literature. Literatures from such political areas are also subject of interest for post-colonial studies, since the emergence of post-colonial studies in the academic disciplines or introduction of this approach in the discipline like English, post-colonial studies, comparative literature and world literature. But quite often, the authors of the literature of these political regions refuse to read their literature as post-colonial literature, as their literature carries a history of deeper past and their ancestry. Modern literary genres from Europe were translated into different indigenous literary cultures, but such literatures kept indigenous essence and content alive in their modern literature too. Such literatures in English or in English translation are to revive their past, tradition and heritage. Such writings are also observed as medium to imagine the community's own identity and raising voices of resistance and protest against colonial rule. This category of new literature or new dimension in world literature brings new tenets in whole understanding of English literature. Emergence of such literary categories also gives new shape to the discipline of English literary studies. Though the word or phrase Commonwealth studies or Commonwealth literature is no more valid today, because in wide scale the critics and literary figures, they have refused this term, and that is why the new phrase or new concept like new literature, world literature, all these concepts have been introduced to address such kind of literary fields. And we can understand that such indigenous literature is not only to resist against the European hegemony or just an alternative of European literature, but such literatures offer a different worldview and a history of those communities which was not written. Now let us talk about the concept of new literature in English, Because while we are talking about such kind of literatures, indigenous or aboriginal literatures, we understand that the emergence of such literary categories also reshape or shaken the field of English literary studies itself. It shaken the field of English literature also. New literature in English includes literature of Asia, Africa, the black writing, literature of Canada, Australia, etc. The study occurs based on the comparative methodology in new literature. New literature is a way for understanding literature written in different regions in English from a perspective of post-colonialism. New literature is new in that sense. It is not English or British, but it shares a history of European colonialism because it emerges with the encounter of European colonialism. And why the authors of this indigenous community and aboriginal community, they refuse the concept of post-colonial literature? Because it is their belief, not only the belief, it is also the fact that the literary heritage or tradition, what they are carrying, or the themes what they are adapting in their literature is not happened because of the European encounter, because the themes of the literature, component of the literature, they are getting from their heritage, their age-old tradition, but form of the literature has been adapted from the European literary sphere. But new literature is not limited from this perspective, but it is a wider scope of understanding different world views which are recorded in different literatures. Salman Rushdie, author of The Satanic Verses and Midnight's Children, once asserted that Commonwealth literature does not exist, and he has been supported in his view by other authors. I quote, "Is not this the very oddest of beasts, a school of literature whose supposed members deny vehemently that they belong to it, whose these denials are simply disregarded. It seems the creature has taken on a life of its own," Rushdie wrote, unquote. Rushdie added that the nearest definition of Commonwealth literature he could get sounded patronizing because it appeared to be that body of writing created in the English language by persons who are not themselves white Britons or Irish or citizens of the United States of America, unquote. In general, critics have not yet agreed upon an acknowledged and recognized definition of the term postcolonial. There is an ongoing debate concerning the terminology and what exactly postcolonialism means. Alec Bohemann, for instance, believes that superficially, most modern and contemporary literatures could be called colonial or postcolonial owing to the conquest of British by the Roman Empire. She therefore proposes a narrower definition and focuses on literature written in English in the countries which formally belong to the British Empire. MacLeod claims that there is no definitive consensus on what technically constitutes post-coloniality. So post-coloniality is under huge debate, and many of the scholars, they refuse the whole concept of post-colonialism because the post-colonialism to some extent tries to get all the credit of literary eminence and literary brilliancy of the ex-colonies. So it is quite often refused by many of the scholars, and the in our academic discussion, it is quite often nowadays discussed that it is the end of post-colonialism and post-colonialism as an European concept, because the discovery of literature from the ex-colonies by the British cannot only be tagged as colonial or post-colonial, because such countries or such languages have their long heritage of literature, but British invention or the colonialism has changed some perspective, theme, writing style and understanding. So and the post-colonialism does not carry any particular characteristics through which we can measure some literature as post-colonial or some literature as not. Now let us talk about the concept of world literature, because world literature is also a changing notion. World literature is not a particular body of literature. It is always being changed, and world literature can be defined in different ways from the perspective of the reader, from the perspective of the academician or the literary practitioners. So we have to think about world literature in this context while we are going to talk about indigenous or aboriginal literature of Australia and Canada, because the aboriginal literature of Australia and Canada is not any isolated literary category, because it happens through a greater solidarity from different indigenous and aboriginal literary communities. There is a concept introduced which is called as fourth world literature, and N. Srinivas Rao and P. Srinivishal Reddy calls that fourth world literature refers to the written work of native people living in a land that has been taken over by the non-natives. Fourth world, however, is a term that came into use following the formation of the World Council of Indigenous People in 1972. Fourth world people are the original indigenous inhabitants, those who existed before European or other colonizers invaded, occupied or otherwise conquered or settled their homelands, unquote. So the concept of first world based on the development, the concept of second world also the based of the socialist economy, and the third world, which is not developed as such, but the concept of fourth world is based on the racial discrimination, racial oppression and the affliction of the races in the context of modernity, in the context of new modern world. So in that sense, the indigenous literatures from different countries come into the category of fourth world literature. And it is also interesting that the Dalit literature or the minority literature from India also claim to be the part of the fourth world literature, and the Dalit scholars also find their solidarity and the similarity of oppression and similarity of their resistance, protest against the respective hegemony of the between the black authors of America and the Dalits of in India. So all these literary categories which emerged in the context of new modern world or modernity of literature is considered as the fourth world literature. And this whole very concept of fourth world literature actually changes the concept of world literature and the hegemonic idea or conception of world literature. So the discussion of aboriginal and indigenous literature from the point of view of world literature is also worthwhile. This can also be a perspective to read such literature with the reference of the indigenous, aboriginal or Dalit or minority literature from different geographical and political areas. Universities in Australia, some university, NYU universities in Australia, they offer a course on new literature, and that course introduces the literature of Australia, New Zealand and Asia Pacific region with a focus on indigenous, migrant and diasporic writing. In addition to major text from Australia and New Zealand, they actually encounter a range of works from Singapore, Hawaii and other Pacific island. Some questions they actually tackle in this course include how have the cultural, historical and economic process of colonialism, diaspora and migration connected and shaped this diverse region? How have different authors addressed these processes in their literary works? How have issues of race and indigeneity been central to various discourses of nationalism? What is the place of these issues in early and more contemporary post-colonial literary works in English? What particular roles have Australia and New Zealand as colonial powers in their own right played in the region? Finally, what can the latest generation of migrant writing from Australia show that about new forms of interconnections across the globalizing Asia Pacific? So this is actually quoted from the syllabi of that university in Sydney, and it is also interesting to note that the literature, what they are teaching under the banner of new literature, only does not include the literature of Australia, New Zealand, or the Aboriginal indigenous literature, but the literature of the migrant people also. So they actually address different kind of marginality of Asia Pacific, Australia and New Zealand area. Different kind of marginality and marginal literatures have been addressed through the concept of new literature, and they believe that all these marginalization have some similar kind of shared experience, and it is for the greater solidarity among the literary practitioners and the communities. Indigenous Aboriginal literature also can be observed from a comparative approach, from a comparative perspective. Each indigenous literature or Aboriginal literature, needless to mention that they are very unique, independent, different, and autonomous literary system, and they carry different worldviews altogether, which is not similar to each other. But it is not difficult to have a pan-indigenous or Aboriginal concept of indigenous or Aboriginal literature and their acceptance by the other Aboriginal or indigenous groups. Because of the similar kind of shared history and oppression they had to undergo, and the treatment of the government or the past imperial forces to them as one or same brings a greater sense of solidarity, which makes concept of a pan-indigenous literature. How to approach the problems of two worlds, I mean the world of the oppressor and the world of the oppressed, or the white world and the indigenous world, world of indigenous culture, history and literature, and the world of the white or imperialist or the colonizers, is problem to the comparatives. That how these two worlds and the world view and the literature from these two worlds can be approached together. It is quite often argued that the indigenous literature cannot be understood without knowing the context of that literature or the knowledge about that literature. Furthermore, it is also argued that the indigenous literature cannot be understood properly by the non-indigenous literature. Catherine Deering, in her Indigenous Literature and Comparability, talks about barrier in traditional comparative literature methodology and proposes some new methodologies to talk about indigenous and non-indigenous literature together. Furthermore, it is argued that paradoxically, then reading indigenous literature as colonial resistance is in large part predicated on the fact that it is produced in the languages of colonial domination. And she furthermore argues that the work of developing what might be called bridging theories is already well underway. At the same time, the development of comparative literature as a cross-cultural or cross-epistemological practice will be aided by practical developments in publishing. Indigenous writers and editors are beginning to provide materials with which to build on some of the work already done in comparative studies of indigenous literatures amongst themselves. So she proposes about the bridging theory to approach the literature of these two worlds in the comparative literature department, or even the any literary studies discipline, to read these different kind of literature together. So there must be some bridging between these two literatures. And the indigenous people and the author, they are now handing over their manuscripts and writings to the publishers to publish those into English and to circulate worldwide. So this accumulation of literatures, the accumulations of literary theme, all together can provide the knowledge and impression about the far or distant communities. Because each communities have their distant relation from other communities in this world. So this group of literature, this whole accumulation of literature can provide such kind of knowledge. And this is how, a complete worldview or an adequate worldview can be offered in literary studies about the distant communities. Now, let us talk about Australian literature as English literature. Introduction to About Indigenous Literature by Angeline O'Neill and Albert Braze, they have commented, I quote, "Stereotypes persist, however, while non-Indigenous Australia has fortunately moved beyond the 19th century diffusion concept or Indigenous relationship to the land, according to which a lack of European agriculture signified a backward culture. In various sections of the Australian community, it has been replaced by two popular stereotypes, either a static, romanticized pre-colonial image, which is still propagated in many primary and secondary schools, or alternative Aboriginal people as drunk, disorderly, and criminal. Consequently, Indigenous communities are still not recognized officially as First Nations. It is in response to this context and these stereotypes that many Aboriginal Australian texts have emerged, evidenced in the works of Jack Davies, Odgero Nonukkal, Lionel Fogarty, Mudrodu Arkikrook, Ruby Langford, Ginny B., Sally Morgan, Tara Zun Winch, Kim Scott, and Alex Wright, to name but a few. Canadian literature as English literature. Canadian literature in English, written in territorial Canada or by the Canadians staying outside Canada. Canadian literature in English carries its colonial legacy from British or French colonizers. Indigenous literature of Canada, like other indigenous literature, finds its root in oral tradition, which consists of myths, legends, and folklore. Mi'kmaq literature, Mohawk literature, Anishinaabe and Ojibwe literature, Cree literature, so different kind of literature is included in the field of Canadian literature. The famous literary figure from Mi'kmaq literature is Rita Jo, Charlotte Beer, and the Rita Jo's poetry and Lorne Simon's novel Stones and Switches are very famous literature from the Mi'kmaq literature of Canadian indigenous literature. There are Beth Brandt and other writers from the Mohawk literature of Canada. George Coppoy's autobiography, The Life, History and Travels of Ka Ge Ga Wo, is one of the famous texts from the Anishinaabe and Ojibwe literature of Canada. And some more famous writers from Canadian indigenous writing is Richard Wagamese, Drew Hayden Taylor, etc. Thompson Highway is a Cree writer, playwright, and musician. And his Highway's autobiographical novel, Kiss of the Four Queen, is one of the famous novel or autobiography from this literary category. And there is indigenous literature from New Zealand, and New Zealand indigenous literature also have been translated in different European languages, not only in English. A cite that History of Indigenous New Zealand Books in European Translation by Oliver Hugg carries all the documents about the translation of indigenous New Zealand literature in translation in different European languages. So it seems, it is quite evident that there are greater reception of this literature in different European languages, not only in English. He commented, "The popular appeal of indigenous literature of Ontario or New Zealand has increased significantly over the last three decades. The translation of indigenous books and their subsequent emergence in continental European markets are evidence of a perceptible change from a once predominantly local market to a now increasingly globally read and published body of literature. Despite the increase in the number of translations, however, little scholarship has been devoted to the history of translated indigenous New Zealand literature. Now, let us come to the conclusion. Indigenous literature from Australia and Canada is not any isolated literary category, as we mentioned before also. Such literary categories can be read in connection with or comparison with Latin American, African indigenous literature, and also with the Indian Bhasha literature and the indigenous literature, the lit literature from India. Emergence of this new literature in English or in English translation defines world literature from different perspectives and opens new worldview in literary understanding. An Australian and Canadian indigenous literature keeps record of their own history and restructures their history through literary creation and study. But the significance of such kind of literature is not only limited into this, but it has their outer influence that such kind of literary category or literary field reshapes the whole understanding of English literature, comparative literature, and world literature. And world literature, because of this literary contribution, actually expanded. And world literature can be defined from the Canadian indigenous point of view, Australian indigenous point of view, Indian indigenous point of view, or Latin American African indigenous point of view. So for further discussion, you can consult the links provided here, and you can consult the reference section and the furthermore list. And for self-assessment, you can consult the self-assessment file here. Thank you.